So again, officially welcome to our academic integrity webinar. My name is Adela, and together with my colleague Tomáš, we will give you today's talk. We both work at the National Library of Technology. I have a background in science, namely biochemistry, and Tomáš is doing PhD studies at the Faculty of Humanities at Charles University. This is our plan for today. First, I have to mention that academic integrity is a wide topic and it's not possible to cover all the details in just 1 hour. Therefore, we will try to give you a basic overview and navigate you to further information in case you are interested in getting more details. Today's webinar will be divided into 2 parts. In the first part, I will give you a basic introduction to academic integrity and ethics, including some terminology. Then I will show you some guidelines and documents that you may find helpful during your academic research. And finally, I will provide some examples of good research practice. In the second part, Tomáš will talk about specific ethical issues, and he will give you some real-life examples of academic and research misconduct. So let's start with the first part: what is academic integrity and ethics? For most people, ethics refers to rules for distinguishing between what is right and what is wrong, or between acceptable and unacceptable behavior. Integrity is compliance with not only ethical principles, but also professional standards and values that serves as a guidance for making decisions and taking actions. You can find both definitions, academic integrity and research integrity. They are related and interconnected. However, they are associated with different aspects of academic and research environment. Academic integrity relates to the principles that provide guidances in education, research, and scholarship, while research integrity refers to good practice for responsible research conduct. Actually, both are important for you because you study and conduct research. Academic and research integrity share the same principles, including honest, responsible, and fair behavior to ensure that your work is ethical, trustworthy, and of high quality. Why is academic and research integrity important? Integrity plays an essential role both in research and scholarship. As already mentioned, it ensures honest, responsible, and fair behavior in the academic community. In research, it also prevents from causing harm to subjects of research, including research participants, society, and the environment. Integrity is essential for building and maintaining trustworthiness. It enhances reliability, quality, and credibility of your work, and it can protect the reputation and career, not only of you, but also of your colleagues, collaborators, and institutions. Sometimes it's easier to understand the importance of research integrity if you imagine the consequences of violations of research integrity, because research misconduct and unethical behavior may cause serious damage on many levels. It can cause harm to research participants, damage your career, or destroy public trust in research. This is actually quite serious because the whole research is based on trust. Truthful and transparent results may be validated by other researchers, and it can be also trusted by the society for whom actually the findings are really intended. Here are some suggestions for you for some further reading on academic and research integrity. Now let's take a short look at some ethical guidelines. As you may know, there are documents often called codes of ethics or codes of conduct that define ethical and professional principles, values, and standards to support ethical and prevent from unethical behavior. The codes usually share the similar fundamental principles. However, there may be variations based on national or discipline-specific differences. There are international codes that typically provide more general guidelines and recommendations for self-regulation. Then at the national level, countries may define their own specific guidelines and policies. Then there are codes developed for the purposes of individual universities and research institutes. And finally, at the different stages of the research process, you may need to follow some specific requirements from journals and publishers when submitting a manuscript, or from funding agencies when submitting a grant proposal. Students and researchers should be aware of all the codes and guidelines that are specific to their own studies and research, and follow them at all times during the whole research process. This link may be useful for you. It provides links to various codes and guidelines. And now I will show you some guidelines that you may find helpful for your current or future studies and research. However, following list is not comprehensive, and I will not go into details. The links will be provided so that you can review the most relevant documents and codes for you even later after the lecture. So let's start with the European Code of Conduct for Research Integrity. This code is one of the more general. It serves as a framework for self-regulation across all scientific and scholarly disciplines. It's also often used as a model for researchers or organizations across Europe. Moreover, this code is recognized by the European Commission as the reference document on research integrity for all research projects funded by the European Union. Here you can see the structure of the document, which is pretty much similar for these types of documents. In the first part, the code formulates fundamental principles, namely reliability, honesty, respect, and accountability. Then in the second part, the code describes good research practices that are based on these principles. These include various aspects such as research procedures, data management, or publication. I will give some more examples later in my talk. And in the last part, the code explains violations of research integrity, also known as research misconduct, which occur when good research practices are not followed. And these include fabrication, falsification, and plagiarism. And Tomáš will describe these issues in more detail later today. Research integrity is also regularly discussed at the World Conferences on Research Integrity. The outcome of these conferences is the publication and dissemination of new guidances agreed at the conferences covering various topics such as collaborations or research assessment. This is one of the documents. It's called the Singapore Statement. It's focused on principles and responsibilities. As you can see, it's just one page long. And this document is also often used by the institutions as one of the models documents for their codes of ethics or codes of conduct. Speaking of national concepts, for the Czech Republic, there is a document prepared by the Ministry of Education, Youth and Sports from 2005, it's only available in Czech. Then there is the code of ethics for researchers of the Czech Academy of Sciences as the non-university public research institution. For other European countries, you can check this website, which provides resources and country reports with information about national structures for research integrity. You can just simply select the country. If you are a student, there is the code of ethics of your home university that applies to you. I have selected some of the Czech universities, and here are the links for their codes of ethics. Also, if you have a collaboration with another university or research institute, make sure to be aware of their standards concerning research integrity. Here, just an example of the Stanford University Code of Conduct. If you are conducting research at one of the research institutes, there are also a code of conduct or a code of ethics for you to follow. These are just a few examples. I have already mentioned the code of ethics for researchers of the Czech Academy of Sciences. However, each academy institute has specifications applying to its discipline. Here, for example, the IOCB. Here, I would also like to mention that there may be specifications in ethical principles for individual research fields and disciplines, such as medical or clinical research. And sometimes you may also need to contact the research ethics committee or institutional review board for some kind of ethical approval or other assistance. For example, this link provides a list of committees for ethics for individual faculties at Charles University. When submitting a manuscript, it's important to be aware of the policies of the individual journals and publishers regarding publishing ethics, and also to follow the instructions for authors on how to prepare and submit a manuscript. Guidelines and policies vary by publisher. We have selected some of them, but of course, you will need to check the specific one of your choice. There are also some more general guidelines provided by the Committee on Publication Ethics. Most research funding agencies have also developed their procedures and regulations to make sure that the funded projects comply with ethical requirements. The requirements and reporting standards may be different for individual agencies and their programs. Here you can see just a few examples of the documents. For example, the ethics self-assessment is quite extensive, and it covers various aspects such as human participant and personal data. I forgot to mention that this is the document required when preparing a grant proposal for Horizon Europe from the European Commission. And now let's move on to the last section of my talk. In the following slides, I will give you some examples of good research practice. We will not have time to cover everything in detail. Moreover, there may be some specifications for individual disciplines. However, it should give you an idea of some of the more general practices that may help you conduct quality research based on ethical standards and to produce trustworthy results. So let's start with the safeguards. Research should always be performed in compliance with all relevant regulations so that no one is harmed and society benefits. When conducting research involving human participants, animals, or personal data, you may need to arrange appropriate requirements such as ethical approval, GDPR, or informed consent. As for the research environment, institutions promote open communication, supervision, and transfer of knowledge skills. For you, it may be important to try to improve your skills and knowledge by attending various trainings, courses, and conferences. During the whole research process, the good practice is to apply accuracy, objectivity, and critical thinking, and manage your data properly, including data documentation, organizing, storage, and sharing. If you want to learn more about data management, there will be another webinar called Introduction to Research Data Management on the 27th of March. So you are welcome to attend. The registration is still open. And in the case of collaborative work, it's important to define roles and responsibilities of all partners involved and to discuss things like material or legal aspects of the project even before the start of the project. When publishing research results, it's a good practice to provide clear and complete description of materials and methods to ensure transparency, reproducibility, and validation. All contributions should be acknowledged properly, including authorship, sources, citations, and funding. It's also necessary to always read the instructions for authors of the target journal and follow their policies and requirements, including various statements, declarations on data availability, conflict of interest, author contributions, and even some more. In summary, good research practice should cover the entire research process from the beginning to the end, including responsible planning, conducting, and reporting of research. Even before starting the project, all ethical aspects should be considered in detail and during planning and design, and then throughout the project, the research should be conducted according to ethical and professional standards to ensure trustworthy and high quality research and results. Of course, sometimes it's not easy. You may be under pressure with deadlines and funding requirements, but try to keep your integrity, good planning, and data and time management is really important. Therefore, here are some online tools that can help you plan your research and academic work, such as various checklists. And I have also included some more interactive tools, such as games, applications, self-evaluation tools, or even interactive movie. So I hope that you'll find this interesting and useful. And I wish you good luck with your high quality research based on high ethical standards. And now I will hand it over to Tomáš, who will continue with his part on special ethical issues.
Yes, so after a good research practice, we come to the bad research practice and examples of such. I'm going to start with the most common, possibly most serious issues in science. So these are falsification and fabrication. I'm sure you already heard about those. I assume it's quite clear what they mean. Falsification is basically manipulating the research, any part of the research, so it fits the author's purposes. Fabrication, on the other hand, quite similar, but it's not manipulation, but completely inventing stuff again, so it fits the author's purposes. Obviously, these can happen on purpose. We're not going to waste time trying to persuade you not to do it, not to want to do it. But especially falsification, or you know, instances of falsification or accusations of such could also come up unintentionally, just by mistake. So how to avoid such situations? Again, as Adela already mentioned, try to be really, really well organized, meticulous when working with your data. Do not tamper with the results. Always keep the raw data, you know, for each stage of your research. Try to keep a documented research plan, or ideally also a research log, so you can always trace back any possible mistakes. And double check your work, not just by yourself, but also let someone else have a look at it. You can return the favor eventually as well. Very quite specific subkind of falsification is image manipulation, which is one of the most common ones, actually. And it's not always completely clear, as we'll repeat again throughout this rest of the presentation. Nothing is very clear in ethics. So it's not always completely clear how much manipulation, or let's say adjustment in an image, is still okay, and where is the line behind which it is already a problem, an ethical issue. So probably, you know, increasing high brightness or enhancing the contrast to make the content of the picture more visible is probably fine, but then removing parts of it, or cropping it, or adding something into it, or obscuring something, that is most likely a step too far. Where you're not sure, you should consult either your supervisor, or ideally have a look in the policy of the journals. You can also consult the editors as well about it. So it's always better to ask for an opinion or advice, rather than to be accused eventually of image falsification or manipulation. So here are links to some tips, or like more general ones, but if you already know where you're going to publish, it's good to follow the specific guidelines of each journal as well. There are some pretty famous high profile cases, or have been in the last couple of years. The most recent one concerns image discrepancies at Dana-Farber Cancer Institute. As you might know, this is probably the most famous, most successful and important cancer institution, or cancer research institution in the world, affiliated with the Harvard University. And several months ago, it's like data sleuth, what they call them, a scientist called Sholto David raised the issue with some of, actually dozens of publications by authors working at this institute. And some of these publications were published by very high profile journals such as Cell, Nature, etc. And he noticed that all the images there were either manipulated, or just, you know, duplicated throughout different publications. And the Dana-Farber Cancer Institute actually reacted to it quite well, I think we might say, because some of the publications are being retracted at the moment, and corrections are being issued for the ones that are not being retracted. So things are happening, and at least the institution reacted quite well. Another case is a bit older. It happened a couple of years ago, and since we have quite a numerous audience from Brno, you probably might know about it. It concerns the choosing of the new rector of the Mendel University in Brno a couple of years ago, when it's quite young and very successful scientist worked in fields of chemistry and molecular biology. His name was Wojtech Adam. Was chosen as the new rector, but actually during this procedure, it became quite like public knowledge that some of his many publications, a few of his many publications, were reportedly involved again some manipulated images in it. And again, the university reacted very well because they set up an international ethics committee that was supposed to look into a dozen of his of these reported articles, and the committee eventually came to the conclusion that six of them should be retracted, three more considered for retraction, and that there was really like a serious suspicion of image manipulation. And Vojtěch Adam at first wanted to, you know, go ahead and becoming the new rector of the university, but the pressure from the academic community eventually led to his resignation one day before he actually assumed office. So he became the rector who never was. And the last case I have here is quite huge. I mean, my opinion, much bigger than the previous two, because it concerns potential fabrication in Alzheimer's research. And this spans over like 16-year period. It concerns mainly two authors and dozens of their publications, but also there is a strong possibility that, you know, this fabrication led science astray for 16 years. The research was looking into ways of curing Alzheimer's that was completely blind alien and eventually might lead nowhere. And so much money was misspent on it. So many people were treating with drugs that just didn't really have any real hope of working. So if you're interested in it, feel free to read a bit more about it. What I also like about it is that there are no good guys in this story, because again, as with the first case, we have this scientist who you know, raised the issue with these publications, who flagged them as very suspicious and they should be scrutinized and looked into. But he didn't do it just because one day he woke up and thought, well, maybe today I will have a look into the Alzheimer's research if there's something suspicious in it or not. No, he was actually paid to do it by some businessman who asked him, look, we'll give you like a lot of money, I think about $18,000, if you look into this and then tell us if there's something wrong in these publications. And these guys who actually made this task or this this order to into the Alzheimer's research then made a huge amount of money, because as a consequence, the stocks of the company that was developing the drug based on this research went steeply down, and somehow, don't ask me how, because I'm not a financial expert, they just managed to make a huge profit on it. So there's this meta ethical twist, and really, like, I don't see a single good guy in this story. It's quite interesting. Okay, let's move on. Let's move on to plagiarism, which is the third, after falsification and fabrication, third most common and probably most serious issue in science. I'm sure you heard all about it, basically using other people's work and ideas without giving them proper credit, pretending they are your own ideas. We can distinguish between different types of plagiarism, but you know, the general definition still applies to all of them. There is anti-plagiarism software, as you probably well know. A lot of universities use this software, most commonly, I think, Turnitin. So it's really easily discovered if you just copy and paste stuff. What is interesting about plagiarism is that it's both ethical and legal issues. It's not as common as you might think. It's actually quite rare. So very often when someone's accused of academic misbehavior, they might respond that, but I did nothing against the law. Well, you know, there are more important things than the law, like academic integrity, for example. At least it should be important for academics. Again, we have a very recent real-life case of plagiarism, although it is, again, not very clear-cut. And it concerns actually the president of Harvard University, Claudine Gay, who resigned earlier this year after accusations of plagiarism. But the thing is that the plagiarism probably wasn't really the reason why she was being like pressured into resignation. It didn't seem like serious case of plagiarism, to be honest. I mean, feel free to look into it by yourself, but in this case it seems that this accusation was rather used as a tool to force out someone who just didn't really, you know, fit maybe the political atmosphere at the university and in the country as such. So it's like really another good example why you should really be careful about this, because even when you just make a minor error which is easily corrected and didn't really have much consequence, it can be used in these power games as a tool to hamper your career and as a researcher or even as an academic such as Kulingay. Again, we can talk about intentional or unintentional plagiarism. Unintentional obviously can happen quite easily. You just forget to make a reference to the source of the information that you used. There's also the possibility of this phenomenon called cryptomnesia. I don't know if you heard about it. It's a kind of an interesting phenomenon. It means that, you know, you read or hear about something and then you forget about it, but you only think you forget about it, but it still stays lodged somewhere in your mind. And eventually, and it could be even after several years, it pops out again, but this time you think it's your own original idea and you think it's so great that you have to write a book about it, and you do that, and then it turns out it wasn't your idea at all. You just forgot that you read it somewhere, and you can be easily accused of plagiarism after this. So I don't think it happens very often. It might also be used for alibi, but just so you know, this thing exists. So how to avoid things like these? Again, you know, try to be really well organized, meticulous when writing and working with citations, so you don't like forget to reference any sources. You can also give it a try with the anti-plagiarism software. So before you submit it, you can just run through it, so you make sure that you didn't omit anything or that you don't suffer a serious case of cryptomnesia, which should really resolve that issue as well. And what really helps, but it's probably the hardest thing to do, is try not to rush things at the last minute. I mean, I know we all have deadlines and it's difficult, but try at least to reduce rushing things at the last minute as much as you can. Especially like don't leave referencing just as the last part of your writing. I mean, you should do it consistently throughout as you write. There is also such kind of plagiarism that is called self-plagiarism. So yeah, you can also plagiarize yourself if you present your previously published findings as original. Again, there was a high profile case of this some years ago. This concerned the very successful, famous sociologist Zygmunt Bauman. It is a bit different, I would say, in social sciences and humanities and technology and natural science on the other hand, because in the former, authors usually follow some grand ideas, grand narratives for decades, and they are bound to repeat themselves. It's not so common in maybe your area of studies. In any case, it's quite easily avoided. Just, you know, cite yourself. If you're mentioning something you published before, just make a reference to it. That's it. It's not very complicated. On the other hand, don't overdo it. Don't overdo citing yourself too much. Again, it's another ethical issue, because you probably know some authors as well as I do who always take really good care to make a reference to everything they ever published, so they can kind of boost their impact factor, their statistics, which, you know, unless it's relevant to the actual publication that they are writing currently, is a problem as well. So just cite yourself if it really bears any relevance to what you're doing now. Another area where issues might come up is authorship. It's not as common as the previous three I mentioned, but still, we have these like double issue of ghost and gift authorship. Again, you can probably guess what it means. A ghost means that you ghost someone who made really like important contribution to the research, and you don't mention him as an author. Gift authorship is the opposite, right? You just gift. You just gift authorship to someone who didn't really contribute that much at all. Again, how to distinguish what is enough work to be considered an author and what is not enough might not always be clear cut. At least try to, if you're working in teams, try to set it out clearly from the beginning so everybody knows what they're doing and if they're doing like enough to be considered an author. Although I know changes might happen throughout the research, but it's good to at least have some good starting position, clear starting position. What might help is also this credit contribution roles taxonomy, credit contributor roles taxonomy, which is becoming quite common also for publishers who sometimes require author contribution statement, actually. So if you submit an article and there's five authors, they also want the author contribution statement for each of them, what they did, what they did to deserve to become to be mentioned as authors. And once, you know, you just contribute a little bit and it's not really enough to be an author, it's enough to be mentioned in acknowledgments. That's what it's there for. And this is not by all means all the issues in science. There are so many and new ones keep coming up all the time and the old ones keep staying with us. So this is an overview of more and more possible ethical issues. You probably know about the first ones, predatory practices, like predatory journals and conferences. But just to explain them briefly what it means, those are like journals and conferences who pretend to be regular scientific scholarly publications and events. They also tell you that they practice like peer review and everything that you connect to scientific literature and good practice. But actually, they pretty much fake the peer review. I mean, it's very lax if there is one at all. They just accept anything. They publish anything. Why? Because they collect the fee for publications. Usually, work in this open access mode. And they just do it for the money and they publish anything. It's a scam and it's nothing to do with science at all. It just pretends to have something to do with science. How to avoid them? It's not always easy, although some of them are pretty obvious. You can check for typical characteristics, although you know they don't always apply. Some of the scammers are smarter than others, as we all know. What is good is to look in Web of Science and Scopus. To their so-called whitelist, so the list of publications that actually is involved in these databases, or you can take a look at their list of excluded journals, because sometimes they exclude journals for some sort of misbehavior or another as well. And you can, of course, always consult your supervisor, librarian, or colleague if you have suspicions about any journals or you're not sure, because it really does not reflect well on authors to have their name connected to predatory journals on conferences. There again, there were some high profile cases such as the current rector of Charles University that you might read about. It never looks good, so try to avoid this. And there are, again, a lot of other issues. For example, Vanity Press, it's a bit different than predatory journals. It's kind of similar. Like once you publish anything, you probably already know, once you publish anything, your name is out there, you just keep getting emails from these predatory journals and Vanity Press and all these. So we probably know them already. There are also some controversial journals at the moment, mostly Hindawi and MDPI. as publishers. So some of their journals became quite controversial because they have this weird business model where they publish a huge amount of special issues and they recruit just like a temporary special guest editor, and the peer review is not very rigorous. And then actually one or a couple journals by MDPI were actually excluded from Web of Science last year. It was quite a big big case. Hindawi had dozens of journals excluded from Web of Science, so I would probably avoid Hindawi. But MDPI as a publisher is probably mostly still fine. But if you want to publish in a journal that follows this business model of issuing a huge amount of special issues, you should probably stay away from it, because it might just happen that in a few months they might get a really bad name as well. Peer review already mentioned. So again, there are issues like what is the correct one, open or blind. I mentioned faked peer reviews and all that. Evaluation research is problematic in itself. How do we measure science? How do we finance it afterwards? It's an ongoing debate that it will probably never end. Publishing industry has huge problems to face, especially also in connection with artificial intelligence and technology in general, which can be used to easily fabricate text and images, although some technology might also help to detect fraud and errors. And I would like to also mention retraction. I will start with rejection, which you know, should be, or it's like a regular outcome of a peer review, right? You either get accepted or rejected. It's fine. If you get rejected, you try somewhere else. You maybe change the publication a bit, upgrade it somewhat, and you might get accepted somewhere else. So no problem at all. Retraction is a bit different. I already mentioned the word before, because retraction happens after the publication was already published. So this is what how a lot of these reported misbehaviors, malpractices end up when it concerns something that was already published and it gets retracted. What it means, usually it stays in the database of the publisher, but it gets this you know, big red notice that it was retracted, and there should be also explained why it was retracted, what's wrong with it, or what's suspicious about it. How does this happen? Well, someone might report, someone from the scientific community might report it. Again, that concerns the cases I mentioned before. Or also, you know, you as the author might report yourself, because you might realize after you already published something that something might have gone wrong during the research, that the data is actually not as clear-cut as you thought it was, and then it is your ethical duty to report it to the publisher, because you don't want to mislead the scientific community. So retractions, I would like to say they are not very common. They are still not very common, but they are getting more and more so. You can see here on the left side from an older research, sorry, 10 years old, what are the most common reasons for retractions. And you can see it's mostly fraud, errors, and plagiarizing. And surprisingly, big amount of concurrent publishing. So that is something we probably haven't mentioned yet. You're not allowed to submit the same article to more than one publisher at the same time. I know that the review process takes very long time sometimes, and you have your own deadlines until when you have to publish something, but you cannot like solve it by just distributing it to numerous publishers and wait which one is the first to publish it. You have to wait until the end of the until the outcome of the review process, and then you can try another publisher. So as you can see, some retractions happen also because of this. And on the right side, you can see that just in last year, the number of retracted articles more than doubled. So it's becoming more and more common because, again, I would in this case point to the advancement in technology and artificial intelligence. It's either more and more common to fake stuff, or it is we have better and better tools to discover it, probably both. So you can see that rejections are not so rare anymore. And it's also a good idea to keep in mind when you're getting your literature for your research, you should get it from the official databases of the publishers once, because that's the legal and ethical thing to do, but also because that's where you see the retraction notice. If you get your literature somewhere else, for example, Sci-Hub, just you will not know whether the article is retracted or not. So yeah, it's better to follow the official channels. Now we are reaching the end. I mentioned so many kinds of scientific misconduct and all its consequences, which are really like serious for the authors and the publishers and the institutions, but still it keeps happening. So this is more of a question for you to think about. Why does it still occur? There we might have variety of different answers to it. I think the one that stands out is you know, this pressure for publishing, the publish or perish culture, which just sort of puts pressure on scientists to publish as much and as fast as possible. And then, you know, I'm not saying that it leads everyone to falsifying stuff on purpose, but it's definitely much easier to make mistakes if you rush things, as we mentioned before. It's good to stay updated about these issues, because I already mentioned that they keep evolving, new ones come out, come up, and also the ethical codes might evolve along, especially like with the artificial intelligence advancement. What I would like to highlight from these sources is Retraction Watch, which keeps a database of retracted articles. So if you just want to check on, maybe you're using some publications that you're basing your research on them, and you just really want to make sure that they have not been retracted in the meantime, you can search for them in the database of Retraction Watch. I would also like to highlight PubPeer. I don't know if you heard about it. It's basically this public post-publication peer review forum for scientists, and it is actually the place where most of the cases I already mentioned were reported first. It's where scientists, scholars raise the issues with some articles that, you know, images might be manipulated in this or the other, and what do the rest think and all that. So that this is where often these controversies start. Now I'm going to move on to the summary of what we've been through and the learning outcomes. What I would really like to point out first and foremost is that ethics are an integral part of research process. It's not something that you might or might not face once or twice in your career as a researcher. No, it stays with you throughout the whole career, throughout the whole research, from the very beginning to the very end, and even longer. So you should always keep the ethical issues in mind. We mentioned the most common breaches, these sort of unholy trinity of fabrication, falsification, plagiarism. I already mentioned before, there's not always clear-cut line or straightforward solution for every issue, because norms and practices, requirements, they are different in different places and they evolve in time. And that's why it's important to stay updated. You should always be aware of your institutional ethical code and the ones of your journal or you know, funding agency. That is the minimum you should do for sure. And to avoid problems, the good practice that Adela mentioned before is to be meticulous when working with data and resources, and you know, aim for replicability of research, stick to the scientific method, and respect your colleague, society, and the environment. If you run into any issues when you're not sure how to proceed or you need an advice with anything, you can also schedule consultation with us. As Adela already mentioned, some of us are doctoral candidates as well. Some of us already passed that, and so we can relate to the issues you're facing and hopefully advise you so you can avoid any possible issues. You can also attend some of the other webinars we do. And we also have some tutorials, manuals, subject guides, stuff like that. I would like to highlight STEM Skiller, which is very comprehensive, detailed skill set map for early career researchers and their mentors. So any questions you might have about like anything, basically, you can look in there and the answer's probably there somewhere. So that's it from me at the moment. Thank you very much for your attention.